Hey, it's Mike here, and today, high-carb vegan diet. Am I a high-carb vegan? Do I have fatophobia? We're gonna look at these questions and mainly look at the pros and cons of high-carb vegan diets. In particular, we're gonna talk about things like nuts and saturated fat on a vegan diet and some habits that might not be the best that come along with high-carb vegan diets. And I'm gonna talk briefly about Neil Barnard for a second in this video because he's been criticized recently, and finally a little bit about staying vegan and all them vegan quitters. Let's go. High-carb vegan eating is espoused by various plant-based doctors and has a pretty historical role on the vegan YouTube movement. There have been various brands of high-carb diets, some that have given people some good benefit, others caused some issues. So let's start on the pros and cons of high-carb vegan diets. First, let's start with the good. Why not be positive? First point is super low saturated fat. Well, normal vegans eat less saturated fat than people that eat meat and dairy. A high-carb vegan will eat even less saturated fat, and the fact that vegans still do show heart disease means that there's something that normal vegans aren't doing right, and this could be one of those things. High-carb vegans almost entirely avoid oil, which is a processed food, and I've talked many times in multiple videos about the negative effects of oil, the artery function impairment, and so forth. Next point, we at least know that some of these healthier cultures have been eating around 80% of their total calories from carbohydrates, so it shows you can be healthy at least eating at that ratio. Next, higher carb vegan diets have been clinically shown to reverse heart disease and diabetes. Now, this doesn't mean that it's the only vegan diet that would do this. It means that that's what the doctors like and that's what they have studied. So we have the evidence for things like Dr. Esselstyn unclogging arteries. We don't have that same level of heart disease reversal with something like a low carb vegan diet yet. And it's unclear as to whether a low carb vegan diet could do this to the same extent. We have people who are a massive risk for dying of heart disease, people with advanced cardiovascular disease, and when you put them on a diet, you're kind of trying to lower the total amount of fat that's going through their system, lower all that cholesterol and everything so that arteries just have less stress and there's less chance of just, that's a heart attack, and then dying. For example, we know that lowering saturated fat is gonna lower cholesterol, and that's great, but if you're still pounding down unsaturated fats, they can potentially still raise triglycerides, which can be a risk factor as well. And so you don't want a big spike in triglycerides when your arteries are super delicate. And as for diabetes, you wanna dodge those intramyocellular lipids, the fat getting in the muscle cell and interfering with just how well insulin works. And it's totally unclear what the cutoff of fat consumption is for this. We just don't have enough research yet. But it makes sense. If you're eating a super high fat diet versus a low fat diet, you'd have a lower level of that and hopefully a better working insulin system. All right, now let's look at some of the cons, some of the bad. And the first one is that high carb comes with a culture of smashing it down, of over consuming calories just for the sake of eating more calories. As I mentioned in other videos, over consuming carbohydrates that your body literally doesn't need could lead to you just having to exothermically burn it off. And that means your metabolism is gonna burn it, which you have oxidative stress as a result of. And that's how aging happens. And it's just not a good thing to do. And if you eat even enough, way too many carbs, you'll end up putting on fat. Another bad idea that tends to come along with high carb vegan diets is sugar coating sugar. Sugar is obviously still a processed food, and I hate to ruin another food for you guys, but I'm gonna do a sugar video at some point, but I think everybody knows that it's not a health food, so hopefully I won't get as much hate. But the irony of just like avoiding something like an avocado and then pounding down processed sugar is just, it's mind-blowing. Anyway, on to the next. Because a lot of people put a ton of emphasis on carbohydrate consumption and calorie consumption and macros in general, they tend to completely forget about eating vegetables. I've definitely forgot about eating vegetables at certain points of my life, and that's not a good thing to do. Vegetables are good, eat salads. The next point is heavily restricting or entirely removing nuts. And back to Dr. Esselstyn, I'll paraphrase this, but you can read the whole thing if you want. Really, because they have a decent amount of saturated fat, people with heart disease shouldn't eat nuts, but it's a different story if you don't have heart disease. But I will add that not all nuts are super high saturated fat. It seems that pretty much across the board, nuts are associated with favorable outcomes in the epidemiology. And if you find a really compellingly bad nut study, share it down below. Collect those nuts. I will say the walnut industry has funded quite a few studies, and we'll get to a couple of them in a second. But first, there's this meta-analysis, which doesn't appear to have their funding, of 29 studies, and the results are pretty absurd. They're pretty nuts if I don't, shut up. Those results are that nut consumption was associated with a much lower risk of a huge variety of diseases like heart disease, cancer, diabetes, even mortality, and neurodegenerative diseases by 35% in that case, and that is no joke. Now here's a review of a lot of nut-related studies, and it is actually funded by the walnut industry, but they did put together this chart of non-nut-funded studies, which is pretty compelling. The chart shows for what associations are worth that you have a lower risk of death from heart disease if you eat more nuts. And looking to this one, feeding trials also show that nuts lower LDL, and the worse your LDL is, the more it lowers. Now you might be thinking the reason nuts are so good in these situations is simply because it represents people taking animal fat out of their diet and replacing it with nuts, which are lower saturated fat. But there are also some other good things in nuts, and to quote the walnut industry, because this is just factually accurate, quote, some bioactive constituents of nuts, such as tocopherols, phytosterols, folic acid, selenium, and magnesium, are purported to have antioxidant, anti-inflammatory, or anti-carcinogenic properties. Finally, I want to look at this walnut industry-funded study, just because it's an interesting premise. They took people and gave them high saturated fat, horrible meals, and then they either gave them olive oil or walnuts, and then they measured their endothelial function, their artery function. The result is that the walnuts acted as a buffer for artery function, while the olive oil did not, and from the study, quote, in both study groups, flow-mediated dilation was worse after the olive oil meal than after the walnut meal. Again, flow-mediated dilation is just how well your arteries are able to dilate. It's your artery function. And yeah, olive oil is not a health food, once again. Again, take it with a grain of salt, because that walnut money is just rolling in for those scientists. But in a nutshell, yep, I just said that, there's really no strong argument against not consuming nuts at all. It's just no. But I should echo the words of Esselstyn. For those who have heart disease, yeah, you probably should remove all of that saturated fat from those nuts. But if you're a normal person, I mean, there's tons of benefits of nuts. In moderation. And now I want to briefly talk about Neil Barnard, because he has hailed some criticism recently from someone, and that was for being fatophobic, among other things. But I want to do a quick response to this. First of all, Neil Barnard is a freaking hero. He has done so much good in the realm of diabetes research, reversing people's diabetes. I would go as far as to say that he saved countless lives. He's also done some amazing work with the Physicians Committee for Responsible Medicine lobbying. Diets and so forth, and getting places like Geico to try a vegan diet and get crazy good results. And in case you're wondering what his opinion on nuts is, here is a direct quote. The good news is that not all fats are bad fats. A handful of nuts and seeds, which pair well as a salad topping, can provide cognitive benefits thanks to a healthful dose of vitamin E. But this brings me to a larger point that a lot of times people are really hypercritical of vegan public figures or other vegans in general. And I want to say that looking at any other person on earth, there's definitely going to be something that you disagree on. And is that enough to write them off entirely? I don't think so. And I would hope that me and you don't agree on every single thing, because once that happens, no one's thinking for themselves. So keep an open mind. Deep thoughts. Now I want to talk a little bit about omega-6s, which could technically be our final point on the cons list, as possibly not getting your minimum daily requirement of omega-6s. Normally, people are trying to minimize omega-6s so much. People massively overconsume them on a Western diet and on a processed vegan diet, normal higher fat vegan diet. And so omega-6 is bad, avoid at all costs. The reality is that omega-6s are an essential fatty acid, and your body needs at least a certain amount. And depending on the source, it seems to be around 8 grams for men and 6 grams a day for women. You'd think it'd be higher for women, but that's what I'm getting. As an example of how an obsessive high-carb vegan diet could go wrong, I typed some numbers in a chronometer, surpassing 2,000 calories of foods while only getting 24% of the total requirement of omega-6s. The final point here is I can't think of a single benefit that you would get from not reaching your minimum of omega-6s, but there certainly would be a potential risk there. So that's my only point. Obviously, you want to get omega-3s to balance it out. All right, moving on. What is my diet? Do I consider myself a high-carb vegan? I first and foremost consider myself a whole food vegan. Of course you'd say that, Mike. I'm lucky enough to not have any diseases that I need to reverse, and so I don't really focus on my macros a ton. And some of you have seen from like my how to make pizza video that I used a lot of cashew cheese, and that was probably a little triggering for some people, but that was a little higher on the fat end. But in general, you know I love whole starches, and whole starches end up getting me pretty high up there on the carb spectrum. Usually, but it depends. I also love avocados. But if I did find out I had heart disease, which would be really, really crazy considering my total cholesterol is 110 and my LDL is 50, then I would be dropping nuts down to almost nothing or nothing. All right, now I want to talk about saturated fat in terms of my diet. If you are avoiding oil, it's really hard to get a lot of saturated fat except for one thing, and that is coconut cream. I did the math on the back of this can like 5 times because I used to throw a whole can of this into my coconut curry and basically eat all of that myself. Sometimes it'd be 2 cans of curry for multiple people. And each one of those cans has 70 grams of saturated fat. That's like eating a stick of butter. So you gotta watch out a little bit. In terms of nut butters, yeah, you could go crazy with some nut butters, like peanut butter's a little bit more high saturated fat, but for 2 tablespoons, which is a decent amount, you know, you're only looking at 3.3 grams of saturated fat, and other nut butters are lower, like almond and sunflower butter are only 1.4 grams of saturated fat for that same amount. So if I were to summarize my diet, it would be a whole food vegan, low saturated fat diet. Other than that, you know, whatever happens, happens. Maybe I'm oversimplifying, but I think you get the idea. Finally, I really briefly want to end this video talking about people going off the vegan wagon. Recently, there's been a few YouTubers bouncing off and sometimes back on and on. It's confusing. And since I don't want to do a whole video on it, I just figured I'd mention some brief things here. One thing that Derek Simnett said on his channel, which really resonated with me, and that was that a lot of these people that tend to go off, we're trying all sorts of crazy things, crazy types of vegan diets.
Some of the time, what happens with people when they find a vegan or plant-based diet and they're trying to heal some health conditions on their own is they gravitate towards like special extreme niches of a vegan or a plant-based diet. And then they jump around from one to another and try a whole bunch of different things. You know, just raw foods, only fruitarian, super high fat, you know, one meal a day, like I mentioned. You know, drinking turpentine, as you know, one of these YouTubers did, super long water fasts as well. You know, just all the extremes. They might be masking some of their symptoms that they have, but they're not actually healing the underlying issues that they're suffering with.
And furthermore, that it's never gonna be news that people are just doing good on their vegan diet. There's never gonna be like a video of, oh, Mike the Vegan is still vegan. That's not a headline. I'd also say that a lot of people go on a vegan diet expecting absolute perfect inhuman health, and people still can get sick. I mean, just because vegans have lower levels of things, for example, maybe 78% lower diabetes, which we've seen it that much lower in certain studies, that still means some people are gonna get diabetes. And so the moment those people get diabetes, they're just gonna be like, I'm gonna quit a vegan diet, even though it made their risk way lower. And my final point is, yeah, it's frustrating to see like long-term vegans go off the wagon, but that doesn't mean that the movement isn't still growing and expanding all over the world. But in response to all this hype about people failing to stay vegan, I decided to make a shirt, which yeah, admittedly is a little bit cutesy, but it's Namaste Vegan, as in, nah, I'm gonna stay vegan. Some of you are familiar with the Namaste in bed meme, probably. And because I know it's not everybody's style, I'm gonna go ahead and make it super limited edition, maybe just do 1 or 2 little campaigns on Bonfire. And if you wanna get in on the first campaign that you will receive the shirt by Christmas, you have to order it before the 10th, before December 10th. All right, so that's it for today. I hope you guys found this hodgepodge of a video somewhat interesting. And so yeah, just be like the Zen bunny rabbit and stay vegan. All right, see you next time. Feel free to like and subscribe. Bye.